This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Albaugh, along with Aaron Zomers, our magnificent engineer and producer on the board. It is 6 past the hour of 12 noon on this Wednesday, November 13th, 2024. It is a great day to be Wisconsinite, and it is...
Hump Day!
The camel got out. He ran away.
Oh, like those monkeys down in South Carolina.
Yeah, exactly like that.
Which I heard, by the way... Yeah, 32 of them have been recaptured.
But only 32.
But so they're saying that the rest had been living in the wild prior to being captured for research, and so that some people are saying just let them roam. And I'm with them. Let the monkeys roam.
They're not hurting anybody.
They're not hurting anybody
at the moment. No. And hopefully ever.
Right, exactly. Glad to have you along, everybody, on this Wednesday. A little bit of overcast skies here in Madison. Brittany Merlove from our meteorology department says that it could be a little wet going into tonight and into tomorrow as well, and then clearing off for the weekend. And if you're watching on the stream, it appears there's an earthquake going on right now in Madison as well. Not really. The table's a little wobbly again, but it'll be fine. Seven past the hour of 12 noon. Glad to have you along with us. We have a new What's Worse coming up in hour number two. What's Worse, the ever important questions of the day. This one has to do with the holiday season. So we'll be asking you what's worse in hour number two. Right now, though, and by the way, Pat Kreitlow from Up North News Radio normally joins us on Wednesdays. He is taking a well-deserved vacation to Indonesia. He's there.
Is that so?
In a hut and going through a ayahuasca ceremony. And he has people.
Who is he has Pat?
Yes, and he has people rubbing his feet.
I thought he took the pontoon out and then like tried to submerge it in the lake so he could join Eric Hovde.
No, Pat's out. He's seeing family. He's just hanging out with family. A well-deserved vacation. He'll be back next Wednesday. But as we always do, our friend, native Wisconsinite, fellow Wisconsinite from River Falls, a former Republican like myself and now a senior advisor at the Lincoln Project, it's Trygve and Todd for the next hour. Trygve, my friend, it is great to see you. Just great to see friends.
It's good to be back.
Right?
It's always, yeah, 100%. And you know, Todd, we weathered the storm. Mm-hmm. Literally. Right. Didn't work out very well for the pack, but you and I, we weathered the storm.
Well, thank you very much. Trygve got the tickets for us and appreciate it. And we hung out at the Lions-Packer game. And you know what? A lot of people said, oh, my God, it must have been terrible. You know what? It was actually really great, if you want to know the truth, because it wasn't really that cold. And no. the best investment I've ever made, perhaps in my life, was a $8.99 Packer poncho at the Packer Pro Shop that kept me relatively dry. Trygve was decided to, you know, be the alpha of the group and not get the poncho. So he got a little wet, more wet, but it was great.
You know, but I had my Gore-Tex on, so I wasn't like I was
and
cold.
And your heated vest.
I had my heated vest too. I did have that. So I was snuggly. But I'm headed to Chicago, Todd.
Are you really?
Again, for the big tilt. Mm-hmm.
Very good. And we're going to see each other.
With my kiddos. I love Chicago.
It's a great town. It's a great town, and the great thing is, when you go to Chicago as a Packer fan, you can wear your Air Love shirt that just says "Who's your daddy?"
So. You can do that. The other thing that the last time I was at Soldier's Field, it was raining crazily, and Brett really? Favre was the quarterback for the Packers, and I think the score was 35-0 at the end of the third quarter. The poncho was helpful because the Bears fans were all throwing beer.
Really?
From the upper deck. Yeah.
And right there. That's a
they
great...
weren't very happy. And I thought, what a bunch of knuckleheads. They're throwing right. beer. And it's a rainstorm. Everybody's got ponchos on. Why are you wasting good beer?
And you know,
who does that?
That's a
people
great
from Chicago. I
yeah,
guess.
People from Chicago. This is a great point. You and I and a few other people were there at the Packer game. And like you always say, nobody was wearing a red or blue hat or wearing green and gold or blue and silver. And we had a lot of Lions fans around us. One of your friends happened to be a Lions fan. And you know what? I didn't see any fights going on. Nobody was dumping beer on Lions fans' head. I mean, everybody was just there to enjoy a game and a common experience. And that's what it's an oversimplistically take, I know. But I think that's just a great analogy of where we should get back to as a country.
Well, I'm not necessarily optimistic about us getting back there in the short term. But as you know, I have deep faith in the people of Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, Wisconsin is one of those states that had a mixed verdict, right?
Right.
Like you had Donald Trump won the presidential election, Tammy Baldwin won by a point in the Senate election. Wisconsin is a place, quite honestly, where people don't wear red and blue as much as they wear green and gold. Mm-hmm. And it's important for people to remind those who are trying to wear red or blue that really we need to focus on wearing green and gold. There's real problems that need to be solved. I think the elections pointed that out. And I think both sides need to do a fair amount of soul searching and inspection, because at the end of the day, Wisconsin and the United States and the world more broadly, we're either going to be built on the notion that we hold faith in each other, or we're going to be a world which is not so great, in which we all live in fear of one another. And having been in a lot of places where fear is the modus operandi, and we're maybe seeing some of that today across the country. There are people that are afraid. And there are people that are actually relishing the fact that there are people who are afraid. Mm-hmm. In the long term, it's a pretty miserable place to be for everybody, because fear ends up being something that's contagious for both sides. So we've got to figure out how to have people that will lead and restore that notion that we should be having faith in each other. And that starts at the local level and the community level.
Let's go to the phone lines quickly. 855-752-4842. 855-752-4842. Matt, listening in Middleton on WMDX. A great question. The subject at hand. Matt, what do you got?
Hey, guys. Love what you do, and thank you. My question's for both of you, but mostly Trygve. I'm a central-left guy, very worried, but also trying to look at potential bright spots with people and the idea of behind MAGA, some of the things they want to do. But I look a lot at the world and the shifting dynamics, and Professor Richard Wolff had a pretty good thing the other day. The fact of the matter is America is not number one, and we're not the top economy anymore. The BRIC nations are outdoing us GDP-wise. They have more people. The idea of shipping millions of people away, you know, you're not going to be able to compete with the numbers. So how is there a chance that we will have a kind of moment where we try to share the world, focus more on Latin America, America and Canada as a bloc, helping the EU? Because from what I see and hear, the EU is kind of in a dead place economically. They're kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place. America's on the way down. We have all this fear, like you said, which I think comes from the fact that a lot of people feel the empire is dying. And there's a lot of fear around that economically. And we're not getting good answers on either side to make us feel better in that way. And I know that's a big loaded question, but do you think there's a chance that we could come out of this and share the world, so to speak? Thank you.
Thank you, Matt, for the question. Thanks for the compliment. Trygve?
So, I think one of the things that people maybe are less cognizant of is the notion that one of the things that truly has made America great and has been the foundation, quite frankly, of the post sort of Cold War era, and certainly the post-World War II era, is the notion of soft power. Mm-hmm. And Ronald Reagan used to talk about it a lot. John Kennedy would talk about it. You know, it's the shining city on a hill. It's the, we go to the moon because we can. I think really the challenge of the election is, you know, people around the world in the post aftermath of the Cold War were standing up to tanks because they believed in the notion that they wanted to be free. They wanted to be democratic. They believed in that notion that we had set out. Those who were opposed to it tried to equate democracy with chaos. And I do think, and you know, not to sugarcoat things, one of the issues that we're going to face as a country moving forward beyond whatever is pursued in terms of policy is that soft power that people truly aspired to be like the West. And that some of that has been stripped away. As far as the economics go and sharing the world and, you know, the truth of the matter is, I think, I'm not sure that Xi and Putin and those people want to share the world with us. They want a reordering of the world order because they were losing when we had that notion of soft power. So they want to realign economically, whether it's the U.S. as the reserve currency, the dollar, and what was came out of Bretton Woods, the idea of NATO and joint defense. They would prefer that you have great power rivalry. So that they get to dictate what happens in Taiwan if you're China or the Russians in Ukraine. I think the people that have rebelled against the world that we have built in globalization and would prefer to return to some of those things under the, you know, return to a great power rivalry and sort of what that world looked like before World War II and certainly after the Cold War, they may find out that they didn't like what they had, but what they're going to get might be worse.
Yeah. I think that's where we've talked about this show. I've been saying this a few times, of course.
And I hope I'm wrong.
Right. Right.
But I don't think I am.
We have to clean it up for radio, obviously, in a broadcast radio situation, but there's a phrase going, you know, it's been around for a while. And I feel that Tuesday people decided to mess around and now we are in the era of find out. And I think there's a lot of unknowns that we're going to find out together, good or bad.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, on lots of levels.
855.
Although we have some models. I mean, right. You can go to those places.
855-752-4842. 855-752-4842. We'll talk about some of those places. Talk about the election a little bit more. Give you a little hope maybe along the way. What things went right. Take your phone calls and texts as well. It's the All Ball Show for a Wednesday right here on the Civic Media Radio Network.
You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. 21 now past the hour of 12 noon. Zomer is nailing it on the music this morning. This afternoon, I guess it is. I still think I'm in the morning. look, Trygve, here we go, right? I mean, not the first time that you and I have been up against some odds and that American people have been against odds. This is not the first time. And I think that for me, at least this last week, it's been not so much blind, like, oh, I'm not going to pay attention to it or be naive, but try to be reflective, be a sponge, try to think about what this show, what we do here, how can we be inclusive in terms of listening to people while not also giving up our principles? I mean, everything that I've said, and I believe everything you've said on the show for the last year and a half, we believe in still. But I think it's a good time to be reflective and say, okay, well, how can we talk to folks or with folks or listen to folks that could be inclusive without giving up principles? And I think that's healthy. There's a healthy venue for this program.
I agree with that 100%. And I think one of the things that might surprise some of our listeners is, I mean, I still consider myself a conservative, much more of a traditional Reagan-esque conservative. So on a lot of the foreign policy things, you know, I tend to, quite frankly, being aligning myself more with what Joe Biden was doing than what Donald Trump is saying he's going to do. Do I think there have been some things in terms of how we've approached foreign policy that I would do different based on my experiences? Yes, but, you know, like, I'm not sitting there in a policymaking position.
Right.
But that being said, on a lot of, you know, social issues probably, and certainly economic issues, I'm probably to the right of a lot of our listeners, and that's okay, right?
Right.
Like, those are regular disagreements that we can have. I'm a big believer in the Constitution and that we have a set of rules and you follow the rules, which, you know, sometimes drives my wife and kids crazy. But I'm a kind of a big rules guy.
We got a few more phone calls here. 855-752-4842. 855-752-4842. People just like you. Like, you're like Sally Field. You're the political Sally Field. People just like you, Trygve. Gene and Eau Claire, for one, listening on WCFW. Gene, thanks for listening. As always, what do you got?
Well, thank you, guys. First of all, thank you for all the work that you have done on behalf of democracy. I just can't thank you enough. And I'm wondering if the Lincoln Project will continue. They're just so outstanding. Just, you know, I wish all America could have seen all the information out there from the Lincoln Project, and I hope people support it. In addition to that, I'm wondering, Trygve, as you have worked with in other countries, how do I reconcile the picture in my head of watching live the January 6th attack on my country? How do I reconcile a man who has a criminal history, who goes after women, sitting there as my president of the United States? And I believe in the rule of law also. I have always followed them myself, no matter what. And so I'm wondering, how do I reconcile in my head this type of thing? And I've never been in a resistance. And it's a new word for me, resistance. How do we help our country go to a better place? It's a big question, but I got a feeling you have some ideas. Thank you.
Sure.
Thanks, Gene.
Yes, thank you, Gene. So as to your question, yes, Lincoln Project is continuing to do what they do, and will continue. But to your bigger question, and quite frankly, I think the more important one. So, you know, voters spoke, right? And we have a system, and that system, you know, voters made a decision. For those who, you know, preferred a different option and felt like that was a bad choice, given January 6th, and, you know, will he adhere to the constitutional rights that that are bestowed on all of us as Americans? I think those are legitimate questions to be asking. In terms of what do we do, you know, we need to, we still have those rights. Tim Snyder, who's wrote a book on tyranny and several other books, professor at Yale, super smart about these things, and he and I've been on a panel once together. He makes the point that people should not give up their power on their own, right? They should not, out of fear, give up power until they're forced to. And that's important. The Constitution of the United States still governs the United States, whether people around the president think that's the case or not. And there are still institutions that are supposed to uphold those rules. And you're seeing that in some places. You had a Donald Trump appointed judge in Louisiana, of all places, say that schools could not be forced to have the Ten Commandments up because that was unconstitutional. So we have to have faith in each other. We're either a nation where we have faith in each other, or we live in fear of each other. Mm-hmm. And we, in terms of how do you stand up to it, quite frankly, it's being a voice for when you see things that are wrong, using your voice.
Mm-hmm. No, I couldn't agree more. Let's go quickly to the phone lines again. Mark, listening in prayer to Sac. Mark, about a minute left. What say you?
Yeah, thanks so much, Jeannie Rocks, and thank you, Trygve. And fidelity to the Constitution is extremely important. And one has to remember that the founders were men who were steeped in political history, you know, especially that of Greece and Rome and of the various attempts at democracy through history, and that they didn't rely on the Bible. And they remembered what happened in Rome when Rome collapsed, and they tried to get rid of the Roman what the Romans had for their constitution, what happened to those in power, that power can slip away from their fingers very rapidly, and do they want to have the chaos they may release upon our country? And going back to mythology again, one can't help but remember the legend of Pandora, and I see her box or her jar that she opened up and released evils upon the world and the nation, that I think what Trump is going to do. But remember that what remained was hope.
Yeah, appreciate it, Mark. Thank you so much. Got to hang on to that, Trygve. Got to need some hope here in the next couple of years. Talk more about a little hope. Hear what Secretary Pete Buttigieg is saying about the election, your phone calls as well, and a Packer preview by a Packer owner. Don't miss it. It's the All Balls Show for a Wednesday on the Civic Media Radio Network.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. HeroicDeed.com.
Welcome back to the Town Hall Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. 34 now past the hour on this Wednesday, November 13th. November 13th, Trygve. It is the birthday of one of our very special friends and favorite people in the world, Chris Andrews. Happy birthday. There you go.
Yay.
Look, I mean, you can speak for yourself. I've known Chris since, as much as she hates to admit it, since I was 12 years old. And she was a very young staffer on Congressman Steve Gunderson's campaign out in western Wisconsin. And, you know, became kind of friends through politics. And then she ended up hiring me to work for Congressman Scott Klug when she was Klug's chief of staff and a mentor there. And just been, and her late husband, Morris Andrews, just been wonderful, wonderful, tremendous friends. And if there's a person, and I think it's important to say woman in my life, who has just been exemplifying strength and intelligence and leadership in this state and in politics, it's Chris Andrews. I want to thank her for that publicly and say happy birthday.
Yeah, I mean, Chris was my first mentor, and quite frankly, you know, after college, I went out to work in Washington for Gunderson. And, you know, Chris is the person who actually said to me, I was a staff assistant and they had an opening for a legislative advisor. And Chris actually is the person who said to me, you know, I think you like campaigns better. Like, I really think that
really?
Would be, a, yeah, and help, yeah. Mm-hmm. And really, yeah. Impacted my life in so many ways, and I'm so happy to say still does to this day. Mm-hmm. We worked together on several things, and just one of the best people that you could meet, and I'm incredibly thankful that my daughters have gotten to know Chris and have her as a role model. She's just amazingly good people. Yeah. And you know, she is an example, quite honestly, as she and Morris were, that there are things far bigger than our politics in life.
Right.
You know?
I mean, they were kind of the James Carville and Mary Matlin of Wisconsin for some time.
100%. 100%. And the thing about Chris is, whether it's people, Democrats, Republicans, everybody likes Chris.
Yes.
You know, and she cares about the things that has made this state great.
Yeah.
The university system, public education. Yeah.
So there you go, Chris. Well, Chris Andrews, one of those things that makes, one of those people that make Wisconsin great. We send our best regards out to her. And here's to you, Chris. Another trip around the sun to health and happiness. Cheers, my friend. Last to get to Trygve once again, I want to bring up a couple of things here. First of all, I guess before we go, I want to hit the Senate leadership election today. I think that's important. But before we move on from last Tuesday's elections, he's former mayor of in Indiana there, Pete Buttigieg, the current transportation secretary, Pete Buttigieg, I believe still, and moving forward perhaps, going to be one of the true stars of the Democratic Party. But here was his take on the election. I believe this was from an appearance at a foundation event yesterday.
One thing I believe, and I've been reflecting on it a lot in the last week, and I say this, I did not come here to add to the pile of takes that are out there. There are plenty of takes. There's some really good ones, like John Della Volpe's recent piece. There's some half-assed ones. I'm not here to offer a take. But one thing I believe, and I believed it in 2017, I wrote it in 2017, and I still think it's true, is that in moments like this, our salvation really will come from the local and the state levels. Something that, again, sometimes Democrats have lamented, right, our federalism, like we kind of would like a little more consistency at the federal level, but a lot of the answers are going to come from mayors, from communities, from states that aren't captive to some wacky ideological project. They're just focused on getting things done. Now, embedded in your question is the fact that we haven't always, those of us left of center, haven't always covered ourselves in glory when we've been given a free hand to get things done. I think a really good project for a lot of folks in the academy to take on is to evaluate which states that had a trifecta used it better than others, more creatively, or got better results for it. In particular, there is healthy introspection going on right now on the left on the topic of how we may have gotten in our own way in terms of getting stuff done. The one that's provoked the most discussion, I think, from people like Ezra Klein and Matt Iglesias is around housing. But of course, transportation and clean energy projects, this is clearly something we got to look at.
And it kind of goes on from there. Trygve, I think he's preaching the right message there, and I think he pretty much nails it, but what say you?
You know, I'm going to disagree with you a little bit, Todd.
How so?
So Democrats have this tendency to come at things with the notion of we're going to create a policy for this or a policy for that constituency. And he's kind of going down that path. What didn't we do, you know, for this constituency or that constituency? Donald Trump won because they built a narrative. They built a narrative about Harris. They built a narrative about Democrats. They built a narrative based on hope. And the reality is they made inroads in places. Here's the thing, like student, and there's this might not be popular, but like student loan forgiveness. Okay, I get that to a degree, but the Republicans took that and made a narrative out of it for, you know, a Latino working guy probably who has, you know, has an F-150 that he needs for his job would like debt relief for that. Like it's a slippery slope. And Republicans successfully built narratives. The big one being, you know, sort of the wokeness, starting with, you know, women, men transitioning to play women's sports. I get it's not a real thing. I get that, you know, it's about pronouns in those ads. And they didn't confront those. Tammy Baldwin won, I truly believe this, because she confronted that to the camera. They have to stop going into so deep into policy, and they need to start building narratives about what's transpiring if they're going to successfully confront this.
And you're talking about, for those that didn't see it, about the last, what, week and a half, 2 weeks, Tammy Baldwin did put up ads where she was looking
right. It was right, the last 5 days that she put the ad up.
And she looked right into the camera and said, Eric Hovde is lying. Stop it. And then went on to tell the truth.
And he was lying.
Yeah, he was 100% lying.
And he's lying again now by saying right. that he lost the election and he doesn't even have his facts straight and he should just go jump in the lake again, quite frankly. But I'm sure it'll be a lake out in Orange County, not in Wisconsin.
Let's,
that's neither here nor there.
Right.
Here's the other thing about this. If I were, you know, the Democrats need to think about. There's going to be lots of issues that are going to be arising, that are going to be coming up in the next 2 years, 4 years with Donald Trump, where states are going to have very different opinions. Republicans have wrapped this notion, we're a republic, we believe in states' rights. They're even doing that with, you know, what they've done with overturning Roe was all about let the states decide. Democrats need to capture that. They need to build a narrative. Illinois should decide what Illinois' National Guard's going to do, and you're not sending the National Guard from Alabama to Illinois or Wisconsin, right? Like, the states, they need to wrap up a narrative of states' rights. They need to take that away, not get into the policy of what Trump is doing. They need to paint big narratives if they're going to have success fighting this. That's the game they're in.
To go back quickly to Buttigieg's comments, I guess I liked what he was saying about making it local and making it state. To your point, I guess. Not so much the policy part, but saying that there's work to be done. And because I think there's a lot of people out there right now that are feeling overwhelmed and in despair because of the results of the election. And it's kind of like, well, there's nothing I can do. We're just kind of SOL out of luck. And I think what I'm hearing from you and Buttigieg is similar in that there is work to be done at the local and state level. 78% of school board referendums or school referendums in Wisconsin passed. That was something that voters went and passed and helped their local schools and communities. To your point, if we have a strong state government and say that we're going to, okay, fine, if this is what you're giving us, state rights, we're going to create that narrative. I think there is focus and work to be done that is possible locally at the state level.
I agree with that 100%. But where Buttigieg struggles is then he goes into talking about, well, we didn't do this policy or that policy, and we could have done more on this or that. Stop with that and build narratives around it and encourage people at the local level. We can stand up to this at the state level in our states because we believe states have rights. We can stop this. That's what they need to be doing.
I want to move on quickly, Trygve, because I think this is important. I had a couple of texts from listeners on this. The United States Senate Republicans, which Republicans are going to control now, the new Congress, the new Senate, they had their elections. John Thune beat Rick Scott and who was it, Texas?
John Cornyn.
Thank you, John Cornyn. So Thune is the winner on that. Break it down, Trygve. You worked for McConnell for a while. You know the United States Senate better than anybody I know, particularly on the GOP side. What does this mean?
I don't know the Senate that well, Todd.
Better than I do. I worked in the House.
Right. And the real enemy is always, if you're in the Senate, the House. And
right.
The House,
exactly. Exactly. The right. 100%.
I think it's a pretty big deal. You know, the sort of hardcore MAGA forces wanted Rick Scott badly. Rick Scott promised that he would just do recess appointments. John Thune says to me, he may not be perfect, but he's better than the alternatives in terms of that he will stand for the institution of the Senate and its constitutional role within that process. And John Thune will be under a lot of pressure from Trump, the MAGA wing, to supersede the Constitution, and have the institution unilaterally give up power. I don't believe you're going to see John Thune unilaterally give up power.
And that's a good thing. I think
that's a very good thing.
Very good
that
thing.
Is how, you know, the guardrails of democracy held on this.
Right.
And that's important. Little battles. And here's why people should have hope. And people are sitting around, what can I do? It's so much bigger than me. You know what? It starts at your local level. Stand up to the crazy. When somebody is, you know, a bunch of people are advocating that they need to ban the Kill a Mockingbird in your school. Stand up, say that's wrong. Go to a school board meeting.
Run for school board.
Right. You know, right. But the sensible center has to be, you know, needs to be holding because and build narratives around them. It's crazy that they would be book banning. Really?
Right. I'd be remiss, and we could come back after the break if we need more time on this, but Trump has nominated for Defense Secretary Pete Hegseth, who is a Fox News host. He also happens to be a military veteran, but is not a general, does not have a lot of, to your point earlier, organizational experience. And now talking about this war tribunal type of thing that Trump wants to set up to basically vet generals and the Joint Chiefs of Staff, circumventing the long tradition of military, you know, going through the ranks and earning your way up, and basically a loyalty pledge instead of to the Constitution to a person, meaning Trump.
Yeah, I think he's going to get a lot of pushback on that, I would suspect, from within the bureaucracy. Now, you know, there's just going to be a lot of, it's going to be small victories for guardrails of democracy or small losses. This is all incremental, an incremental game. They're probably going to try and move fast and flood the zone with lots of things to overwhelm the guardrails. We'll see what happens. There is an element of resistance, and you know, that is going to require picking spots. And I don't even like resistance as the word. I don't have a better word. I don't even know that it's resisting. It is resisting, but it's really standing up for what the Constitution is all about. And what we're about. So I think a better word probably is needed for a narrative. But I don't know much about this guy. I know he's from Minnesota. If he's a Viking fan, it probably makes me a little skeptical of him. But
he was also cheerleading on January 6th on Fox News. So there's that.
He was that. That's not cool.
Not cool at all. Come on back. Talk a little Packers. Maybe a tad more politics. It's Trygve Olson on a Wednesday on the Civic Media.
He's going to have a hard confirmation hearing now that Thune won, by the way.
There you go.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
We go Green Bay, we go Green Bay, we go see Packers, we watch them play. When they score a touchdown, we shout to Ray.
Hey, there you go. A little Green Bay Packer music for Trygve Olson, one of the owners of the Green Bay. Always a pleasure to travel with Trygve, and it's the first time we'd ever gone to a Packer game together last week up there at Lambeau Field to Detroit, and I appreciated the fact that he got us in the owner's gate, and they bring you food right to your seat.
None of that
happened. Do we want to talk about your luck at the table, Trygve?
Oh, Trygve, I'm good at craps.
Now, here's the situation. Trygve had a couple of his buddies from River Falls join us, delightful people. Uh-huh. One of his people from the Lincoln Project, delightful guy. And my buddy, Chris Geezy, who was our videographer all week. He did a fantastic job of making us look good. And so... Yep. Went to a nice dinner on Saturday night, and then Trygve and the boys are like, we want to go over to the casino and try our, and I'm Leonardo. Like, I'm already like getting something in my voice. I had to anchor election night, and I know myself well enough. I'm like, I just can't. I had to go home and get some rest. And so they went, and the next morning, wow, Trygve, tell the folks what happened.
I rolled like 26 times without crapping out. I was down to $30. I don't want to tell people what I started with the bankroll, but I had $30 left. I intentionally did not bet it so that I would get a chance to roll the dice. I bet on myself 26 times. Everybody at the table, and I walked away from the table with a pretty healthy profit. They were all asking me to come back. They wanted me to throw again. And what's really funny is, it, you know, Scoop, who's been on the show when we were up in River Falls, he's on the school board, just a great guy. Yeah. He's like the pillar of the community. They all confused me with him. So every time I threw the dice, they were going, Scoop, even though I wasn't Scoop. It's pretty funny.
But you did.
Yes, they wanted me to come back and throw the dice again. I was like, you know what? You know how you win at craps, Todd?
How?
Quit while you're ahead.
Well, let's just say that Trygve bought the first round the next day.
I did buy the first round. I did pretty well.
Andrew in Maine says, is that not the motto of political operatives everywhere? Quote, I'm good at craps.
No, the motto of political consultants is, you got a problem, I got a plane to catch. That's actually the motto of political consultants.
I heard you, Reed, say that more than once.
It's one of my favorite lines.
I want to get to the Packers. I want real quickly.
And you know the career arc of all political consultants.
What?
Who is Todd Albaugh? Let's try Todd Albaugh. Get me Todd Albaugh. Get me the next Todd Albaugh. Who the H is Todd Albaugh?
That might
be true for radio hosts.
It might actually be true for radio as well. You're absolutely right. I want to get to the Packers, but you said something during the break that we got to give people a little hope here, and a lot of people have seen this.
It's all about hope, baby.
Tell us this. Go ahead.
Yeah. So one of the greatest lines, you know, when you've done what I do, one of the greatest lines is from The Hunger Games, and President Snow is talking to Candace Everdeen. And he says, hope is the only thing stronger than fear. A little hope is effective. A lot of hope is dangerous. A spark is fine as long as it can be contained and doesn't become a conflagration. And people need to hold out hope. Listen, there was a little battle won today. You may hate John Thune. You may hate Senate Republicans. You may think Mitch McConnell is something equivalent to Darth Vader's spawn with Dick Cheney. But the truth of the matter is, John Thune winning is a little battle. Donald Trump wanted somebody else. That is a win. John Thune has said, we'll try and get your appointments through as fast as possible. Unlike Rick Scott, who said, we'll do recess appointments and you can have whoever you want. That means those people are going to have hearings. That means this guy who's been nominated for defense secretary is going to have to get up and answer questions about these things. That is a good thing. That's a small win. We can have small wins all over the place for democracy. And we may disagree on what those small wins were, but I'm telling you, that's a small win.
I love it.
That might be a big win.
Right. Might have been a very big win, as it turns out. All right, Trygve, 2 minutes. Da, 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 da. Packers at the Bears this
Chicago.
Weekend. Chicago. What do you got?
How's that new quarterback working out for you Bears fans? That guy... If you watch the show on HBO, you know, the Behind the Lines or whatever it's called, the guy has like a $23,000 purse he carries around with him. It's actually a man satchel, but kind of like in the Hangover movies.
He just loves to poke. Well, here's what I know.
He should be playing for the Vikings, actually.
You and I were at Lambeau Field. I'm going to say, before I get too cocky here, the Packers need to figure out offense, because the offense a couple weeks ago looked dreadfully bad.
Not good. A lot of drop passes. Even Tucker Kraft. And I really like Tucker Kraft. He's a big old South Dakota boy. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't good. But you know what? Jordan Love's going to fix things. I'm pretty confident about that. I listened to this podcast with Bob McGinn, the legend Bob McGinn, with Tyler Dunn, my buddy. And they seem to think that Love will get it straightened out.
That pick six was brutal, dude. You said walk away from the stadium, because we left right before that last score, the Packers, and we heard the fireworks go off, and we thought we were either being shot at or they scored, and it turned out they scored. But you said, hey, had it not been for the pick six, the missed field goal, it's 14-all.
Yeah, right. And remember, hope is, you know, what happens last. Hope dies last.
Close only counts in whatever.
Horseshoes and hand grenades.
Thank you, Thomas. Appreciate it. All right, Trygve Olson, we appreciate you so much. Have fun down there in Chicago. Get the pack
away.
Thanks,
Todd.
All right.
Yeah, we'll talk next week.
Sounds great. Stay tuned. Hour number two, what's worse, is straight ahead on the Civic Media Ready Network.
Well, we all have so much fun. We go Green Bay.
Let's go!
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.